starts to file in to Hinkle Fieldhouse as Buck to take on Saginaw Valley State. Happy Hanukkah to all those of you watching at home for this midweek non-conference matchup. Matt Schumacher and the three-time NBA champ Dickie Simpkins with you. Dickie, it hasn't been the start to the season that Butler wanted. Many around the program feel like this is a season on the brink, although only seven games in. What do you want to see from Butler tonight?
Well, the Bulldogs have been dealing with injury, and the transition has been difficult. But one of the things they can help cure is not turn the ball over as much. Take care of the ball.
Our starting lineup tonight are brought to you by Jeep. And you'll see in the starting lineup, there is no Bryce Enzi. He's out again tonight with a torn labrum in his shoulder. He is expected to return at some point this season, but that timetable is still a question mark. No Chuck Harris either in the starting lineup, but we were told by the coaching staff he will play tonight. He'll just be coming off the bench.
Yeah, Chuck Harris coming off an injury. Bryce Enzi. They play a lot through him. He will be a big player miss today.
Our officials tonight, Tony Chiazza, Tim Clowdy, Steve McJunkins. Butler in the all-white, Saginaw in the blue, and the Bulldogs control the tip. Aaron Thompson, the fifth-year point guard. Missed the first three games with a suspension. Returned against Michigan State last week. A held ball gives it back to Saginaw Valley State. Dickie, what are your keys to success tonight for both teams?
Well, one of the things for the formula for success for Saginaw is pressure the ball like they just did in that possession. Put a lot of pressure on the ball. Make it uncomfortable for Butler to operate offensively. And then Butler just has to finish. As you see the knockdown three by James Tuohy, but Butler has to finish in the paint, finish off defensive possessions with a rebound, and they just have to finish plays all together.
They are averaging 16 turnovers per game, which is good for nearly 25% of their possessions. That's a good shot from Jair Bolden, who has been one of their hottest scorers.
Well, Jair Bolden is a shooter. I mean, that's what he does. He's expanded his game even more, becoming a playmaker. Last game having six assists.
There is Darnell Hoskins making his 92nd career start tonight, and he drains a three.
Now, the one thing about this Saginaw team, they have some veteran college players. Guys that can score. Hoskins, a fifth-year guy, crafty, can shoot.
Good dump down into Bryce Golden, and he goes Bryce Golden to the backside and kisses it off the window.
Very good interior passing, finding an open Golden. Golden using the reverse to avoid the defense of blocking his shot.
Here's Tyler Witts. Talk about veterans. We're number 44 for Saginaw Valley State. He played a couple of years at North Dakota State and the Summit League before transferring for his final year of eligibility. Whistle underneath and off the ball foul. It'll stay on this side.
Well, you can see the three-point package right here. They're starting off games. Tuohy, catch and shoot, nice find to an open knockdown shooter. And then Bolden, this is what his career has been based on, being a spot-up shooter. And here's a guy, a veteran player, defensive player, but he can knock down threes.
Bolden a deep two. Doesn't matter. Foot in front of the line, behind the line. He's pure 2-for-2 tonight.
Well, what was it coach said to us before the game? He said, you prepare well, you play well. Bolden was out here 2 hours before the game preparing with his jump shot, had the managers rebounding, and is paying off right now in the early parts of this game.
Shot rejected by Ty Gross. 13 on the timer. Here's another look at that shot from Bolden.
Well, you prepare well. You play well. At least you give yourself a high chance. Shot preparation, locked in, exaggerated follow through, and that was the early reps he got in before the game.
And he's a guy who's been really vocal for this Butler team, who struggled a little bit this year. As Ty Gross gets into the passing lane and finds Bolden in transition. And Bolden takes it to the cup. And he has 7 points, all of them nearly all of them for Butler.
When you have your score hot at the beginning of the game, you have to keep getting the ball. They found him. He knocked down jump shots. The defense pressured up on him. Now he's able to put it on the floor and get to the basket.
Butler with a three-point lead here, 3 minutes into the ball game, taking on a Division II opponent in Saginaw Valley State. Tyler Witz in the lane, rattles out. And now here comes Aaron Thompson. Up ahead to Bryce Golden.
Bryce Golden gets rewarded for running the floor. Aaron Thompson's vision was on him the whole time. The rim runner and a guard who can make a nice touch pass over the defense. Nice finish in transition.
Butler on a run. And a foul off the ball.
And you have a point guard. Well, this is Bolden right here in isolation against Tui, just attacking the basket. When you have a point guard that doesn't have to look at you, he knows where you are. The veteran presence, the vision, and the nice touch on the pass by Thompson. Excellent transition finish.
And he's a guy that this team has missed throughout periods, not only of this season. He missed those 3 games due to suspension, but last season he missed 9 games. Due to various injuries. He had that off-season shoulder surgery and wasn't even cleared to play until the fall. So this team really glad to have him back and healthy. As Ty Gross gets immediately doubled and a whistle is called on Saginaw Valley State. I believe that's going to go against Trey Garrett.
Well, to your point, Thompson has had the injury bug since he's been here in Butler.
As you get a look at Randy Baruth in his 10th season as the head coach at Saginaw Valley State, he said, listen, yes, this is an exhibition game for us. Doesn't count against our regular season record, but we came to Hinkle Fieldhouse to get a win tonight.
Yeah, I mean, they came in here ready to get the win. They just beat Western Michigan and beat them pretty handily. Yeah. So make no mistakes about it. This is a team with veteran players, transfers.
McIntosh finds Witz, one of those veterans, senior transfer from North Dakota State.
And that's the part of college basketball now. You're seeing mid-major schools. You're seeing competitive games because teams, as you saw right there, misjudgment right there in the backcourt.
Unforced turnover, over and back. But Butler's looked pretty good so far tonight.
Well, Black Friday was the other day, so people were out buying gifts. And here's the recipient of an early Christmas present.
Illinois Street, you taste pizza grilled to perfection.
FS1 College Hoops is sponsored by Jeep. There's only one, and there's only one Brad Stevens. Led this Butler program to back-to-back Final Fours in 2010 and 2011. He had a really good point guard in the name of Ronald Norred, who's now down the street as an assistant coach with the Pacers. And he had a guy off the ball that could score it. Shelvin Mack had a long NBA career. But the reason we're showing you this is because Aaron Thompson has now etched his name in the history books of a program with great prestige and great individual players.
Absolutely. Here's a guy that's unselfish, has unbelievable vision, has precision on his passes, can see the court, and he makes sure he takes care of every teammate, making sure they get the shots that they need and where they need the ball. And I expect he's 30, I think it was like 30 assists away from getting to the second spot. He can handle that in four games, if he really wants to.
Well, last year he averaged nearly five assists per game. It's taken a little bit of time to get going this season. Of course, he missed the first three regular season games with that suspension. He's been back since the Michigan State game last week. Just two assists in 18 minutes against Chaminade. Expect him to be way more involved in the offense tonight as Jaden Taylor is off the mark. And here come the Cardinals of Saginaw Valley. Dickie, you touched on it earlier. This is a Division II program, but they are veteran-laden. They've already beaten a Division I program this season in Western Michigan as Freddie McIntosh lets it fly from downtown. And the Cardinals now have made three triples early in this ball game.
And McIntosh from Saginaw, Michigan, a freshman, pure point guard, but he has some scoring ability also, and he's very good defensively.
Thompson on the kick out. Extra pass to Bolden. Nine to shoot. And Bolden backs it in. He's still perfect, folks. 4 of 4, including a pair of triples.
Well, when you're feeling it and your main scorer is knocking down shots, sometimes he doesn't have to call glass. It just finds a way to go off the bank.
Ty Gross got a little handsy on that drive. Foul goes against him, his first.
Well, you see right here, nice penetration by Gross finding the open Bolden. He didn't even call glass, but he turned around and was like, yo, this is what I do. I like it.
Laval Jordan has been disappointed at times with his team's energy, not handling early adversity in games like they saw against Houston a couple of days ago. They were trailing 17-0 in the Maui Invitational. He's challenged his guys to maintain the same level of energy for the entirety of the ball game.
Yeah, and it makes it difficult when you have three important guys out of your rotation that you count on with Bo Hodges, Miles Tate, and Bryce Enzi. As you see, the knockdown shot by Jaden Taylor, the freshman from Indianapolis, adding his perimeter shooting to this offense.
His first bucket of the night. Butler back on top, 17-11, thanks to a 6-0 run. And the freshman Elijah Harrison stepped out of bounds. It'll go back to the Dogs.
Well, you see the ball movement here, the dribble handoffs, but defense, creating offense, getting the steal, seeing what you have coming down. You don't have the fast break, but you have the ball movement. And when the ball moves and bodies move, you get good shot opportunities. And right there, Taylor knocking down a corner three.
That's been a big point of emphasis as well from LaVal Jordan. Ball reversals, not allowing the ball to stick, which we have seen happen a lot for Butler over the last couple of weeks. Taylor, that's back-to-back threes for the freshman.
And see, this is when you have a veteran point guard in Thompson who understands how to get the ball and where to get the ball to the guys who have the hot hand. He was doing that with Bolden earlier, and now he's doing that with Taylor.
9-0 run for Butler. The double comes on Witz. Shot altered on a good defensive play by Aaron Thompson. DJ Hughes off the mark. He just checked into the ball game. Cardinal head coach Randy Baruth wants to see his team run it a little bit more. They can score the basketball, averaging over 80 points per game. And they had over 80 in the win against Western Michigan. Thompson finds Taylor, and a heat check.
The Cardinals will find opportunities to push in transition, but like you mentioned earlier, they have offensive scores at every position that are not scared to shoot, as you can see with Barnett, the 6'5 sophomore.
And not scared to play in this type of environment either.
No, not at all.
They come out of the GLIAC, which is arguably the best Division II college basketball conference in America. And this is a coaching staff that feels like the Cardinals are a top four team in that conference. Aaron Thompson on the back down. Bounce pass to Hughes, and he is on the scoreboard for the first time tonight.
Good job by Hughes with composure on the drop-off pass. He didn't rush it. Took a nice power dribble, got himself gathered, used his body to go through the defense and finish.
And he's a guy, too, who thought he may redshirt at some point this season. He didn't play the first four games, but due to injuries, he's been called upon, and he's getting more and more minutes. Offensive rebound by Barnett. And the three balls are not falling like they were to start the ball game. 2-minute scoring drought for Saginaw Valley. Butler. Halfway through the first half here at Hinkle Fieldhouse. Hughes on Witts. Well defended by Witts. Couldn't pick up the loose ball. And it's last off the Bulldogs.
Butler doing a good job finding the open guys. Their three-point shooting is unconscious right now.
Friday on FS1, the Big East Big 12 battle gets rolling with number 8 Kansas and St. John's, who's still searching for that signature non-conference win. The action kicks off 7 Eastern on FS1 and the Fox Sports app. It's been a really fun first couple of weeks of college basketball. A lot of parity. Saw Duke take down Gonzaga not too long ago in a really good battle. But how about that Purdue team? Not too far away from Indianapolis, about an hour and a half away. Matt Painter's got a group that would scare a lot of teams.
Matt Painter has assembled a team with athleticism, with some post play in the paint, some rim protection. He's got a variety of weapons on that team, and they're playing very well.
I knew you'd bring up post play.
You know, I got to show the love to the post players.
Matt Schumacher, the three-time NBA champ, Dickie Simpkins. Butler on an 11-0 run at Hinkle Fieldhouse. I feel like if there's one team in America that you would play for if you were a college kid right now, it's Matt Painter and Purdue. They love the big man over there in West Lafayette.
They like for their big men to get touches. You know, you don't see big men get enough touches, but at Purdue, Matt Painter is making sure those guys get touches.
Do you see that team losing in the non-conference?
No, I mean, they're playing at a high level. I mean, like I said, they have good guard play, good post play. Defensively, they're long. They have some rim protection.
Yep.
I mean, they have the complete package for a team that you see in the Final Four.
Butler will get to see that Purdue team towards the end of this month at Bankers Life Fieldhouse. Bryce Golden draws a foul, and the first free throws of the night for either team.
Well, it was good defense by Witts at first. He had position. He was able to stay in between Golden and the basket. But at the end of it, he used his hands, brought his hands down and fouled. That's an easy call. He plays it. If he stays high, he makes it difficult for Golden to have to score. He bailed him out when he dropped down.
Butler still riding an 11-0 run over the last 5-16. Long scoring drought for Saginaw Valley State, who at one point had this game tied at 11 after a 6-0 run of their own. As Jair Bolden checks back in, he has 7 of Butler's 22 points, including a pair of threes.
Well, it's not like the Cardinals are missing players who can put the ball in the basket. Delano right now with the ball, he's an efficient scorer, best player on this team, has athleticism, can score in every part of this game.
That's a great point. He hasn't even attempted a shot yet. He's averaging 17 and a half points per game, scored 23 in their win over Western Michigan. Finally, his first shot attempt, and it's good.
Well, that's good that you didn't. Normally, you do the play, you do the announcer jinx. That time, you help Delano get that ball in the basket. Right there, he's showing his ability to put that ball on the floor with touch in the paint.
First field goal in nearly 6 minutes for Saginaw Valley. See if that gets something going here for the Cardinals on the road. Tyler Witts on Bryce Golden. Rebound saved by Barnett. And Hoskins rattles home the second chance.
Well, Saginaw right there, just patient, getting the ball in the Witts, and just hustling more than the Bulldogs. Coming up with the 50-50 balls, the rebound.
Miles Wilmoth on the drive, no. Rebound Delano Smith, and then a foul off the ball. Goes against Bryce Golden, and the officials will get together here as Tyler Witts is a bit shaken up after he was wrestled to the floor. We will step aside from Hinkle Fieldhouse. Butler on top by 10, riding a 12-4 run.
And for your Bulldogs, four, Ty Gross. Timeout. On the court. Fans, welcome to the court, the fabulous Butler University dance team.
Everybody
top 23-15 as we welcome you back to Hinkle Fieldhouse. You just got to look there at Tyler Witts, who was just wrestled to the ground by Bryce Golden. You see his reaction to the call, Dickie. It's a flagrant one for this.
Yeah, you know, what's interesting is Witts and Golden have been wrestling throughout this whole game. Usually guys that don't have that much athleticism, that play below the rim, they're wrestling for position, arms getting tangled. Witts takes more of the brunt of the action because he hits the floor pretty hard. I don't know if it called for a flagrant one based on what I'm seeing right here. I would just go to both of them and say, hey, man, stop with the WCW wrestling. Wrestling, getting your arms tangled up and stuff.
Tyler Witts getting worked on by the training staff. Because he's out, James Toohey is taking the free throws. Free points for Saginaw Valley State. And Tyler Witts has played every minute of this game until this point. Division I transfer from North Dakota State. He was a JUCO All-American before that at Olney College outside of Chicago. And it's now back to a six-point game.
And Witts is being seen by the trainer. Looks like he fell on his lower back. And possible concussion protocol. You have to check all those different things.
So Randy Baruth has subbed in Jarno Ponstra, the 7'2", 235-pound sophomore from the Netherlands. As Delano Smith is off the mark, and now here comes Chuck Harris after he missed the game against Chaminade with a foot injury. Tomas Lukosius has also checked in for the first time tonight for Butler. He wears 41. Smith with the shot clock at 6, and he's bailed out by Bryce Golden.
Foul on the Bulldogs, 33, Bryce Golden, his second.
That is Golden's second. Coming up at halftime, Rob Stone and the gang back in L.A. We'll take a look at Butler's team history, plus we'll have highlights and stats. Certainly plenty of history to talk about, especially recently for Butler. It's a team that's made four NCAA tournaments in the last 8 seasons. Would have made the NCAA tournament in 2020 had it not been for COVID, but Dickie, because of that, they haven't been since the 2017-18 season. And that is a long time for this Butler team, at least over the last 25 years.
Yeah, it's a little layoff there, as you see. Barnett with the nice fadeaway jump shot showing his scoring ability. But Coach Jordan has done an excellent job with continuing to keep this team staying focused on the long game. And unfortunately, like you mentioned, COVID, injuries, those things have stifle the team, and so getting back to the tournament is a big thing that is on the focus.
Knocking down threes is the focus of Jair Bolden. He's in double figures with 10.
And if Bolden continues to shoot like he's shooting in this game, they'll get back to the tournament.
He has been as consistent a three-point shooter in the Big East Conference as anybody. Second in the league with 23 made triples this season. And now here comes Jaden Taylor. On the step through, couldn't get the reverse. Hughes shuffles it out to Bolden. And the rebound ripped down by Delano Smith. 5:30 left in the first half. Butler shooting over 60%. They lead by 7 as Smith got the circus shot to go down.
Did you see how Freddie McIntosh got in transition and he waited for their best player to get down court? He recognized that we need to get Delano going. Waited, pointed to him, he got the ball. Now it's the Delano show.
He's only taken 3 shot attempts in this game, had none through the first 10 minutes. Ty Gross off the mark. You're absolutely right. If Saginaw Valley State has any chance of upsetting Butler here on the road, it's going to be Delano Smith. averaging 17 and a half points per game. One of the best scorers in Division II. Darno Popstra had his shot altered by DJ Hughes. And now Aaron Thompson. Bolden on the pump fake.
Bulldogs didn't take advantage of that opportunity right there. They had DJ Hughes running the court. Got to keep your eye on him. Palmstra was still stuck back in the backcourt.
Freddie McIntosh running the point right now for Saginaw Valley. Down to Palmstra, and the seven-footer got it to go with a baby hook.
Well, I
got to
get a big fella's love. Palmstra is one of the throwback bigs out here in college basketball, a true post-up big. As you saw the footwork, the seal in the paint, nice touch with the right-hand jump hook.
Taking a page out of three-time NBA champ Dickie Simpkins' book.
You got to get that post position, that paint seal, so the your guard can see you and deliver the ball to you.
Aaron Thompson had a good look there in the paint, couldn't get it to go. Butler on a 2:15 scoring drought. It's allowed Saginaw Valley to get back to within three.
You can't take for granted this Cardinal team offensively. You need to be up on them, pressuring them, trying to make them uncomfortable offensively.
Smith to the cup. And now Butler has numbers. Smith still behind the play. And now he recovers. Butler couldn't take advantage in transition.
Another missed opportunity transition-wise.
Thompson aggressively taking it to the cup. He draws a foul.
Well, your best score, Delano Smith, the scoop-de-loo running hook.
Saturday, after finally beating Ohio State, Jim Harbaugh leads Michigan to their first ever Big Ten championship game in Indianapolis, looking to punch their ticket to the playoffs against Iowa. Coverage begins at 7 p.m. Eastern, only on Fox and the Fox Sports app. That should be a really good one, that Michigan-Ohio State game, a thriller till the end. As you take a look at the AP top 10 for football, now this is different than the football playoff top 10, which will come out this week. But right now you got Georgia, Michigan, Cincinnati, and Alabama looking like they are going to be playing for a national championship, which will also be played in Indianapolis. Fun time of year with college hoops and football coinciding. Good news for Saginaw Valley State. Tyler Witts back into the ball game. He's missed about the last 5 minutes after he was wrestled to the ground by Butler senior Bryce Golden. He was given a flagrant one for that. Meanwhile, John Michael Malloy, wearing 35 for Butler, has checked in for the first time, as has Christian David at the top of your screen. Sit down to Witts, and right away they get the big fella involved.
And that's what you have to do. McIntosh, like I mentioned earlier, is a pure point guard, a distributor, good vision, organizing the team, seeing big Witts rolling and making a delivering a good pass.
At one point in this half, Butler was on top 22-11. Offensive foul gives it back to Saginaw Valley, who's on a 14-3 run right now, Dickie.
Well, here you go. You see Witts with the roll, has his hands ready. And McIntosh just dragging the defense and making the pass at the right time for an easy 2 points.
Saginaw Valley has a chance to take the lead on this possession. McIntosh to Witts. Defended by John Michael Malloy. Probably not the shot Randy Baruth wanted to see, but it'll stay here. 9 on the timer.
Well, but I like how the Cardinals are sharing the ball. I mean, that was a bad miss. But the fact that Witts had the post up, he threw it back out, they repost him, and then he saw McIntosh coming off, sharing the ball. And Coach Baruth plays a lot of players, and the fact that they share the ball, that is what helps them take advantage of teams, because they're constantly coming at them offensively and defensively.
They are without Delano Smith, their best scorer. He is on the bench right now with a rest. Late in the clock for Saginaw Valley. 3 to shoot. Garrett down to Witts, who beats the buzzer and gives Saginaw Valley the lead.
You're getting a chance to see some old school basketball in the post right here, with bigs delivering offensively with skill and touch, as Witts taking the contact and making the jump hook.
A 16-3 run over the last 7.5 minutes. Thompson with a left hand finally stops the bleeding. And Butler back on top by one in the final 60 seconds of the first half. You surprised?
Not surprised at all. You know why I'm not surprised? Because I knew that this Cardinals team had veteran players. They had players with scoring ability. And they just showed in the Western Michigan game that they can play with anybody out here. Don't let the Division II part fool you.
Singh stripped, got it back. Now Harrison fighting for the rebound. Bodies on the deck. And it goes out to Chuck Harris. And he wisely pulls it back out as he was going 1-on-4.
Yeah, I didn't know if his freshman mode was going to kick in right there, and he was going to try to score on all four of those guys.
And now Laval Jordan wants to talk things over. We'll take a break with him. Back in 30, Butler on top by one at the end of the first half.
Butler up by one, but right here is why Saginaw is right there in the game, only down by one. Utilizing the ball screen, Butler double teams. Witts goes to the short roll. You call that the short roll. Has the ability to catch, control, touch, and finish. Now that's a big who I could play with right there, get him the ball in the paint, because I know he's going to deliver some shots, some buckets.
You and Tyler Witts side by side. 6'9 Witt, 6'10 Dickie Simpkins. All right, Butler with a 2-second differential between game and shot. What do you want to see here from Butler?
Well, the Cardinals are in this zone right here. You want to turn the zone into offense with the penetration.
There it is. Aaron Thompson gives Butler the lead. Final seconds of the first half. Smith just off the mark from half court. And Saginaw Valley, out of the Division II GLIAC Conference, comes to Hinkle Fieldhouse and gives Butler all they can handle in the first half. Dogs on top by 3 in Indy.
Down by 3 points.
Jair Bolden has 13 points. The rest of the team for Butler, 17. Dickie, how do they get going offensively a bit more and get some more gentlemen involved?
Yeah, they have to continue to get this ball movement right here. Jair's going to always be available to score. He's an efficient scorer, but now Thompson is going to have to get the other guys involved.
Thompson tonight, 5 assists, 4 points in 18 minutes. Much better than his line against Chaminade the other night on a run out for Delano Smith. Hammering it home to start the second half.
If you're the Bulldogs, that is not what you want to happen on the first possession of the second half. Turnover that leads to a dunk on the other end.
Ty Gross is somebody we haven't talked a lot about tonight. No points, just 2 field goal attempts in 15 minutes. 3 to shoot. Bryce Golden rattles it home. He has 7.
And Bryce Golden, being a guy that gets most of his work done in the paint, has the ability to stretch the floor out to the mid-range jump shot, as you saw right there.
Fun matchup on the perimeter between Delano Smith, a fourth-year senior, and the fifth-year Aaron Thompson, who picks up the rebound. Smith behind the play. Butler has numbers.
Butler is not getting the advantage in the transition category when they've been out in pursuit in the offensive transition. Either one too many dribbles, holding the ball too long, and it gives the Cardinals a chance to get back in defense.
Just 2 fast break points for Butler. Shot off the mark from Jair Bolden, who had 13 on 5 of 7 in the first half. Saginaw down 3. They have already beat a Division I opponent this season in Western Michigan, and they did so handily, by the way. It was a score of 80-63 back on November the 18th. Hoskins coughed it up, and here comes Aaron Thompson.
But Matt, even right there defensively, that was just a mishandle by the Cardinals. It wasn't like the Bulldogs forced that turnover. See, what I'm talking about when I said they need to improve defensively coming out of this second half, they are making the game too comfortable for Saginaw right now. Make the game uncomfortable for them offensively.
How would you like to see them do that?
You got to pressure up. You got to get up close. You got to be in arms length. You got to pressure. You got to be on the move as a team collectively.
Good closeout from Jaden Taylor. That time it leads to a run out for Thompson, who's hit hard. Jersey over his face. And now this is a guy, ladies and gentlemen, who's been out a number of times last season due to injury. That shoulder is the one he had off-season surgery on before this season.
He kind of got hit hard in the head. Defender was going for the block, hit Thompson in the head. Then he hit the floor pretty hard. And like you mentioned, Thompson unfortunately has had the injury bug since he's been here at Butler. As you see him get hit hard in the head by Darnell Hoskins, I don't think that was malicious at all. Trying to play the block. Darnell Hoskins coming over, trying to block that shot.
Officials are taking a look at it. Tony Chiazza, Tim Cloudy, Steve McJunkins. You see anything there that warrants a flagrant?
I don't see anything that warrants a flagrant. Again, it didn't look like it was malicious, but at the end of the day, the rule book says any contact to the head as an offensive player going into the basket, any contact above the shoulders to the head is ruled as going to most likely be a flagrant one.
And there was that move at the end from Hoskins where he wasn't totally straight up. There was a little bit of forward momentum with his arms. Great shots from our FS1 crew here in Indianapolis. Here's another look. I think that's the one that may warrant the flagrant.
That view right there. Now, when you see it from that view, it looks pretty hard hit. So that I would agree with you, Matt. From that view, it would warrant a flagrant one.
And for Butler and every fan in the arena and watching at home, anytime one of their players goes to the deck, they're holding their breath. I mean, this is a team that's without three players, including Bryce Inzi, who's now missing his fourth consecutive game. And Aaron Thompson himself missed 9 games last year with knee and shoulder injuries and had off-season shoulder surgery. Wasn't even cleared to play until fall. And you just got the official word from our crew.
You called it, Matt, and it was clear once we saw that angle, but it is a flagrant. The officials declared it a flagrant one, excessive contact above the shoulders to the head. And that's what the rule book has come to now, and you have to stick with that. It doesn't get into whether it was malicious or not. The bottom line, excessive contact to the head above the shoulders.
Well, now Aaron Thompson, who was less than a 60% free throw shooter last year, heads to the line. Knocks down the first. He's had a good night so far. 4 points, 5 assists, no turnovers. That's the big one that LaVal Jordan's been harping on for a team that's averaging 16 turnovers a game so far this year.
Well, they're in a good pace right now from turnover to assist ratio. Thompson, like you mentioned, with 5 assists, but the team only has 4 turnovers when they're averaging 16, like you mentioned. So right now they're at a good pace of taking care of the ball.
Now they look for an opportunity to put some more points on the board.
Good defense by Hoskins, moving his feet, his body.
And it's Thompson with the finger roll.
But better offense by Thompson. That right there looked like a possession where Thompson took it personal and delivered, stayed with it, and had a point to prove to Hoskins.
And without Bryce Inzi, it's a Butler team that has struggled to find points in the paint as an errant pass goes out of bounds. Maybe they need a little bit more of this from Aaron Thompson.
Yeah, I mean, Thompson he's more cool, calm, and collective, but right now you see him smack the arm away. He took it personal. Hoskins doing an excellent job moving his feet, giving him body. I like when it gets competitive like this and personal, as long as it doesn't get out of the realm of the team play.
Butler on a 6-0 run. Rejection from Maurice Barnett. 3-minute scoring drought ended by Barnett, who goes coast to coast. A block and a finish. And it's back to a 5-point game.
Well, the kid from Chicago has deceptive athleticism. Sneaky right there. You saw the rim protection and the block. And just keeping it in transition and using that same athleticism to finish at the basket.
As an all-conference player at the junior college level a season ago, as Taylor's off the front end. And now Tui pushing the pace. Did not see a big first half from Saginaw Valley's star, Delano Smith, who wears number 13, just 6 points. Witz had his shot altered by Bryce Golden.
Good defense by Golden, being physical. Now this is where Thompson has to gather the team back and regroup. I like Golden right there. It's what I talked about earlier when he knocked that shot down. He's not necessarily a knockdown three-point shooter. He can hit him a few times, but right there in that mid-range, that's his sweet spot if you give him space.
Butler starting to stretch the lead out a little bit. They led by as many as 12 in the first half. Saginaw Valley cut it to 3 at halftime. Witz through the double team, left it short, and a good rebound from Golden.
Good help by Bolden right there on Witz.
David to a cutting Thompson. kicked out of bounds, last out on Saginaw Valley State.
Well, this is when you have a mouse in the house right here, taking advantage of the size, the strength, and the ability to put it in the basket.
.14-34 left in the second half. Butler on top by seven from Hinkle Fieldhouse, just minutes away from this beautiful exhibit at the Indianapolis Museum of Art at Newfields. My question is, was our crew working today, or were they just enjoying the sights from the art museum?
Looks like they were enjoying this nice weather today. Nice weather today, get a little museum look.
You know who's making beautiful art tonight in the second half? Aaron Thompson.
You know what? It seems like the energy of the game changed once he got knocked to the floor. It seemed like their leader, Aaron Thompson, got up, took it personal, and set a little fire in this Bulldogs team defensively and offensively. And just when they weren't turning the ball over and only having five turnovers so far, that is uncharacteristic right there of Aaron Thompson.
His first turnover of the night. 8 points, five assists, one turnover in 23 minutes. He defends Delano Smith. And I think the big question in this second half, can he get going for Saginaw Valley State? He had 23 in their win over Western Michigan last week.
Because he's a scorer, he can get going at any time. And I'm sure Coach Maroof is trying to figure out how to get the ball in his hands.
There he goes to the cup, and he gets the friendly roll, now with 8 points.
Well, that's just using his physical strength going downhill. Once he got downhill, got that shoulder out, he can get to that basket.
Thompson draws a foul on the drive. It goes against Trey Garrett.
Delano Smith right there just being deliberate going downhill, making sure he get the paint touch. That's that physicality, those broad shoulders. When you're a scorer, you're going to find a way to put that ball in the basket.
He's a guy that this coaching staff feels like should be playing at the Division I level, but they're really glad he wanted to stay closer to home. Grew up just 45 minutes away from Saginaw Valley State's campus. And we had a chance to talk with the coaching staff today, and they said there's no question Delano Smith can play at the next level, whether that's overseas, maybe he gets a shot in the G League. But he has elite talent.
Yeah, his talent is very good, as you see. David knocked down that three, which I thought he should have took an open three early in the game that he turned down. Now he felt comfortable in a nice flow, open look. But to your point, Delano Smith, athletic, good size, can play the combo, 1-2, can shoot it, get to the basket.
Now a 2-on-1 for Butler. Thompson dishes it off to Golden, rather, who finishes in the paint.
Thompson so unselfish. Golden being the recipient of Thompson sharing the ball. Thompson could have just laid it up. I think he's trying to get that stat. I think he's trying to get those assists, Matt.
Six assists tonight. He's already top five all-time at Butler in assists. Foul leads to two shots coming for Saginaw Valley.
Right here, Golden getting a nice little block, transition, kick the ball up. And right there, this was one of the few transition offensive conversions that the Bulldogs have had. They need more of these to break away even more in this game.
They are 6 of 15 from downtown. And they now have 9 fast break points. They had just 2 of those in the first half.
Well, it was all started by Golden defensively, blocking. And Golden's not known as a rim protector, but he blocks that shot. Gets it to the point guard, 1 dribble, kick up, in transition, put, attack the defense, and now it creates an open 3-point shot.
For a team, too, Dickie, that has struggled in recent weeks to get some rhythm going in the half court, don't you feel like Butler could benefit from more of that transition offense?
I do. I think that they need to find a way. Now, again, we know that Butler's bread and butter for the most part is their half-court offense, their precision with their passing, their cutting. But you have to find transition opportunities to make the game a little bit easier for you offensively. Take advantage of that.
They lead 43-34. Largest lead since the first half for Butler. Jaden Taylor with 5. Christian David tips it back in. And off the bench, he has 5 points in the last 2 minutes.
Well, the Cardinals tried to show some zone right there, but they didn't finish off the zone defense with the rebound. Good job by David being aggressive on the offensive glass.
Barnett high arcing 2 from the baseline goes in. How about that?
Barnett has that scoring ability. He finds mismatches in the game. He can play the 3, he can play the 4. Has a good face-up game, good footwork.
Saginaw Valley State trying to hang in. They trailed by just 3 at the half, and Chuck Harris knocks down his first. And he's on the board with 3 points.
And coming off an injury, that's what we've been waiting for. The Chuck Harris that we saw last season, the explosive scorer he was. I watched games where he would knock down 4 three-pointers in a game. He could definitely score the ball.
First Butler freshman to lead the team in scoring last year in 40 years. Missed that game against Chaminade with a foot injury. Came off the bench tonight. Butler shooting at over 40% from distance, which their offense has relied heavily on so far this season. They have 7 of them in the ballgame. Aaron Thompson dishing it off to Bryce Golden, and Butler leads by 12.
business, our team, better together.
.10:42 left in the second half from Indianapolis, where Butler is starting to light it up a little bit, leading by 12, which ties their largest lead of the game. How about this from Chuck Harris?
Well, this is why Chuck Harris is averaging close to 13 points a game and shooting 40%. Just a nice jab step to create space. And that scorer mentality, if he has space and he can see it, he's going to let it fly.
How does Butler close this out over the final 10 minutes?
Well, I think I still would like to see them give more pressure on the ball, more intensity defensively. They're giving the Cardinals so much space when they have the ball on the perimeter, and it's not like the Cardinals can't shoot the ball. They shoot 38% from the three. Make them continue to make them uncomfortable, and as a team, keep doing well on help defense.
Matt Schumacher, the three-time NBA champ, Dickie Simpkins with you from Hinkle Fieldhouse, and Trey Garrett didn't look like he was ready to catch that pass from Elijah Harrison, and it goes back to Butler.
Yeah, it looks like Trey Garrett is talking about the referee was behind him. I don't think the official had anything to do with you not catching that ball.
That is the ninth turnover of the game for Saginaw Valley. Chuck Harris on the baseline, an offensive foul. They got him for the push. Right back to Saginaw Valley State.
I don't know about this, man. I don't know about this. This is a hesitation. I mean, he didn't extend his arm on that one. That's straight strong. That was a strong man move right there.
That was the old Big East.
That's the old Big East right there, man. That was a grown man move. Can't penalize him for using his physical strength to create space and score.
James Toohey. You're right, Dickie. Saginaw Valley State shoots at nearly 40% from distance this year. They're shooting just 25% from the beyond the arc tonight, which is something that Butler's been really good at defensively. Opponents shoot at just 27% against the Dogs this year.
And that's where I want to see that defensive field goal percentage that the Bulldogs have. I want to see it from an intensity energy standpoint.
Harris couldn't get the scoop, and then Lukosius went headlong into Trey Garrett. And that gives it back to the Cardinals.
Now, this looks like a football play right here. We watching the Indianapolis Colts right now. This was a take out the running back. I almost took the official out.
You don't necessarily expect that from Seamus Lukosius, who LaValle Jordan characterizes as more of a finesse type of player.
There was no finesse about that from Seamus. He's got a scar under his eye right now. It came from physical play like that.
Freshman from Lithuania. Butler maintains a 12-point lead. That ties their largest, which they had midway through the first half. This was a three-point ball game at the halftime break. Saginaw Valley, though, hasn't been able to find much of a rhythm. They are on a 230 scoring drought. Smith, off-balance three, but he drew a foul against Jaden Taylor, and he'll get two shots at the charity stripe. Well, make it three.
That was a good defensive possession by the Bulldogs as a team. Golden stood Palmstra up, didn't let him back down. Golden did an excellent job on the ball screen defense, but you don't want to foul a shooter.
Smith just a 69% free throw shooter. A bit surprising for a guy that can fill it up the way he can. one of the best scorers in Division II, but Butler has kept it relatively quiet tonight. He averages 17 and a half per game. Hit two of three, and it's back to 10. 9 minutes to play. Chuck Harris runs the point for the Dogs. Aaron Thompson on the bench at the moment. Gross goes cross court, extra pass from Taylor, and a thing of beauty, connection from Simas Lukosius.
Patience, poise, and precision. Coming down the court, seeing what you have, poise on delivering the passes, and the precision to find the shooter in the corner.
Eight threes tonight for Butler, shooting over 40%. Saginaw Valley, no field goals last 3 minutes. Delano Smith takes care of that. He's in double figures.
Well, I'll give that defensive possession right there, one-on-one defense. Jaden Taylor did a good job on Smith, but Smith just a talented scorer, just raising up mid-range over Taylor.
Lukosius slipped on the baseline. Loose ball picked up by Taylor. And he wrestles it out of the pile to draw a foul.
Foul is on the Cardinals 11. Elijah Harrison is second, James third.
See the precision on the baseline pass. See the three, be the three. Let your voice be heard. Log on to Twitter and check out at Butler MVP. Cast your vote for tonight's PNC Player of the Game. Tonight's selection will be announced right after the buzzer. PNC is committed to all those working.
Back from one of the great venues in American collegiate sports, Hinkle Fieldhouse, first constructed back in 1928, named a National Historic Landmark in 1987, and it is where Butler leads Saginaw Valley State 51-40 as we take a look at Dickie Simpkins' favorite Big East arenas.
Now, you got to understand, this is based on either ambiance, energy, or tradition. MSG, I love to play in MSG, the Garden. Won a Big East championship there, beating Georgetown. We know how special Hinkle Fieldhouse is, and it's tight feel where the fans are here. And then when you go play UConn at Gamble Pavilion, it gets loud in that arena. But Xavier has that Centaur Center That's a sleeper arena in college basketball. And then Wintrust Arena, it's new. The ambiance is great. It makes me feel like when I go to the restaurant, I want that great ambiance. You've had the NBA All-Star event held there. You have concerts. They probably have the best-looking college on-campus arena that has an NBA feel in college basketball.
You're going to take Mrs. Simpkins on a date night to Wintrust Arena?
Get a table set up right at half court. Right at half court at halftime.
How about that take from Jaden Taylor? He extends the lead to 15, the largest of the night for Butler. And the freshman turning it on here in the second half.
I like what I see from Jaden Taylor. He has the limp defensively, comes up with a steal. Look at the ball handling in the open court and the ability to avoid the defense and still concentrate on getting the bucket.
11 points quietly tonight for Jaden Taylor on 3 of 9, couple of trips to the free throw line. Indianapolis product, one of two in this new Butler recruiting class. McIntosh off the mark, rebound hauled in by Lukosius. And LaVal Jordan asks his freshman for a moment of breath. Taylor on the heat check. 15 points off turnovers tonight for Butler. They have dialed up the defense a little bit more as Barnett gets an easy two.
You see Barnett in this game. He's 6'5", 230. He's showing you some athleticism in the paint, dunking it. He's knocked down some jump shots, some mid-range. Barnett, only a sophomore.
Here is Ty Gross. Now back to Harris with four. Harris feeds it off to Golden, who missed the dunk opportunity. And now numbers for Saginaw Valley. Transition triple for James Toohey. And that gets the Cardinal bench involved.
Coach Jordan has to call a timeout. You have an easy miss two that leads to the Cardinals knockdown three. The Cardinals getting in transition, kicking it to James Toohey, lining it up and knocking it down.
A Butler home game is not complete without a TV shot of the mascot blue. Butler needs some blue toughness down the stretch here. They're on top by 11 with just over 6 minutes to play as we get a look at Butler's upcoming schedule. It doesn't get any easier, partner. They've got Oklahoma, who's 6-1. And then Purdue in the Crossroads Classic, the final Crossroads Classic in Indianapolis. They have looked nearly unbeatable this season.
Yeah, those are two games. You're talking about Oklahoma on the road, so you're going to get tested on a road game. You're talking about Purdue, who's playing arguably at a number one in the country level. And then going into St. John's versus a Big East opponent on the road in New York. This will be a test for the Bulldogs before we get to the new year.
For NCAA tournament resume, Butler really probably feels like they need a win against either Oklahoma or Purdue. They have yet to get a win this season against a Power 6 team. Now, of course, playing in the Big East will offer plenty of opportunities to get quality quad one wins. But you schedule these tough non-conference slates so you can go get a signature non-conference win.
Absolutely, man. They went to the Maui Invitational, which was played in Vegas instead of Hawaii. But you want to come out of that type of atmosphere and tournament getting one of those wins versus Power 5 schools or schools that are ranked. They played a Houston that was ranked. You want to get that kind of win.
Butler picked to finish sixth in the preseason coaches poll. It's a program that wants to get back continually into that top half of the Big East Conference.
Yeah, well, the only bone I have is with my Providence Friars at number 7. I mean, they have a veteran team that's come back with Nate Watson, Jared Bynum. I mean, you got guys that are veteran players, and you got them at number 7. What's got a problem with that, Matt?
There's a three knocked down from Freddie McIntosh. And just like that, it's back to single digits with 5.5 minutes to play in Hinkle.
Keep in mind now, this is a scoring Saginaw team. They have offensive power. So don't think this game is over.
Thompson off the mark, tipped back up by Golden. And his pass out picked off by Tui. 4-on-4. Barnett in transition. That's a three. Don't blink now. It's an 11-0 run for the Cardinals, and they trail by 5.
And in less than 20 seconds right there, the Cardinals scored 6 points.
Butler led by as many as 15 points just a handful of minutes ago.
Well, that's how explosive the Cardinals can be offensively.
Jair Bolden, a rare miss from 3. He's been stuck on 13 points since the first half. They'd love to see him get going here over the final 4. A 11-0 Saginaw Valley State run. Here's Delano Smith, the team's leading scorer. Thought he was fouled by Thompson, doesn't get the call. And back the other way goes Butler. Freshman Jaden Taylor draws a foul on the drive. An 11-0 run for the Cardinals. Doing it from downtown. Back-to-back threes. And they're now shooting 38% within 5 on the road at Hinkle. Thanks, Rob. Looking forward to the MLS playoffs on FS1 after this. But, Dickie, before we get to that, there's still 3:58 left, and Saginaw Valley State continues to fight here at Hinkle.
Explosive offensively, the big showing the ball screen to the short roll, and it's more for the short roll to be a passer. He gets in the short roll, and Biggs can pass too, Matt. He has the vision to see McIntosh for a catch and shoot three.
Were you a good post passer?
I was an excellent passer from the post and from the perimeter.
You could have played point guard.
I actually did. It's funny that you say that. I actually did have to play some big point center to help us bring the ball down the court and make plays. So.
Now, that wasn't while you were with the Bulls, was it?
No, that was while I was with the Providence.
I can't see MJ letting you walk the ball down the court.
Yeah, I had to go ahead and redefine my role when I got to the Bulls.
Jair Bolden in and out. There is Bryce Golden on the putback, and it's a big one. He now has 13 points to go along with 5 rebounds, and that stops an 11-0 Saginaw Valley State run.
Job by the Bulldogs, gang rebound.
Aaron Thompson, their fifth-year senior, back into the ball game to run the point. Final 3 minutes. Golden through traffic somehow slipped it up and down.
Very good recognition by the guards of Baylor. I'm sorry. A Butler, recognizing that it was a mismatch on Golden right there. Taking advantage of the little guard and the big.
Barnett in and out that time from three. Golden goes falling out of bounds. Thought he was fouled. Chuck Harris now will walk the ball up the floor calmly for Butler. Final 2:30. Dogs on top by 9. And a 2:23 scoring drought for Saginaw Valley. Closing time for Butler.
Butler needs to create mismatches again with the ball screen.
Or let Chuck Harris knock it down from downtown.
You have a 40% three-point shooter that can knock down shots like Harris, then he saves you all the other stuff on the court.
Chuck Harris, his second triple of the half. He said, I got this. And Butler's on top by 12. Butler on top, 63-51, and a big reason why, Dickie, Bryce Golden, 15 points, 7 rebounds, coming off a 16-7 performance against Chaminade over the weekend.
And he has a blocked shot. The big fella has been very effective in this game, inside and outside. Offensive rebound, putbacks, and right there, that was a big basket that Butler needed. And then you see his footwork. Isolation on the mismatch, taking advantage of Tui on the block. Golden has knocked down some jump shots in this game, Matt, showing his range to the mid-range area, and those are his stats right there, being effective.
They need more of this for Bryce Golden, especially with Bryce Inzi out indefinitely with that torn labrum in his shoulder. He's missed the last 4 games now. Injured against Michigan State before the Maui Invitational. And Butler all season long, even with Bryce Inzi, has struggled to score in the paint and inside the arc for that matter. But Bryce Golden, a veteran on this team, came back because he wanted to help this program get back to the NCAA tournament. And if he continues to put together performances like he has tonight, that will be a reality for Butler. There he is, skying to get the board through contact. And he draws a foul to boot.
Well, he's keeping it simple. He's staying in his role. He's rebounding, doing his job in the paint, controlling the boards, using his physicality. He's using his footwork offensively, not trying to do too much. And his teammates have rewarded him with passes or easy buckets, and he's taking his time with his veteran offensive skill set to deliver with inside moves and outside.
There was Bryce Enzi alongside his teammate Bo Hodges, who's been out all season. Had a tibial plate fracture in the preseason buildup to the regular campaign, and he's a guy too who last year missed time. Cannot overstate the fact that Butler is missing three key pieces right now. They haven't been full strength since before COVID, and they finished that year ranked in the top 25 with a tournament berth pending had it not been for COVID-19, as Jair Bolden was silky with a step back.
Kind of forgot about Bolden from the first half when he started hot, but there he is showing you, don't forget about me. I can come through in the clutch.
Aaron Thompson draws a charge. Winning plays from Butler's veteran players, Jair Bolden, Bryce Golden, and Aaron Thompson.
Right here, Bolden just getting in a one-on-one situation. Nice fadeaway. Keeping the big from blocking his jump shot.
This has been a strange game. Butler's led by as many as 15, 12 a couple of times. Now they're back on top by 14. But there's been some close calls where Saginaw Valley got back into it. How does Butler avoid that going forward against some really tough opponents coming up? We showed you their upcoming schedule. They've got Oklahoma. They've got a good team in Eastern Illinois at home. And, of course, Purdue at the Crossroads Classic.
First thing you do is get in a film session tomorrow and see where you are successful on your positive plays. See where you were successful in your positive plays. Watch film tomorrow. That's how you improve it. And see the moments where defensively, when you show some intensity, you started bouncing around as a team. That changed that segment. You need more of those. But the way you make those changes is you watch film tomorrow ASAP.
And for folks who may be watching not only in the arena but at home right now, yes, Butler's last two wins now will come against Division II opponents. Coming at a rather strange part of the season, you usually see teams play teams out of division early in the year. But LaValle Jordan told us, it doesn't matter who we play. We have to get back to playing our brand of basketball and figure out who we are as a team before it really gets tough with the conference slate coming at the end of the month.
Yeah, this game, this opponent comes at the right time where they're still trying to figure things out with main players being injured. They're still trying to play freshmen to help accelerate their development. As you see, Elijah Harris knocked down that jump shot in the corner. He's a guy that they expect to be a talented player and take the place of Delano Smith as he moves on. But this is at the right time. You can't get caught into whether it's a Division II team, Division I. While you're licking your wounds, while you're trying to figure things out, you have to play like this is any team in NCAA basketball.
With 40 and a half seconds left, Butler on top by 11. What are your positive takeaways in this game for Butler?
One positive takeaway is to see Aaron Thompson play today when we didn't know if he was going to play, watching him at shoot-around. But not only play, the way he played. Distributing the ball, then all of a sudden he got a chip on him, more of a chip on his shoulder that I think set the tone. Another positive was Bryce Golden knocking down jumpers and starting the game off early from the mid-range, facing up, knocking down his mid-range jump shot, running the floor, rebounding the ball. That was definitely a positive. And like you mentioned, he needs to be able to build off of this and continue to do what he did today production-wise.
And Bryce Golden and Aaron Thompson are two of the key players that returned from that team that just 22 months ago was ranked number 5 in the country, almost pulled off a win over unbeaten Baylor, who then went on to win the national championship the following spring. That team for LaValle Jordan was going to make the NCAA tournament in 2020.
Yeah, Golden and Thompson bring this team a calmness, a veteran calmness to keep things in order. They deliver. Nothing sexy about their games, but they're efficient, they're effective. And these guys have to set the tone every game for the other veteran players and for the young players.
So Butler's next game will be at Oklahoma. They struggled against the Power Six, quote-unquote Power Six teams at the Maui Invitational. They lost big to Houston, played much better against Texas A&M, ultimately falling 57-50 to a really well-coached Buzz Williams team. But now you go down to Norman, and you talked about the difficulty of playing on the road in a really hostile environment in the Big 12 Big East Challenge. What do you want to see from Butler in that game that would allow them to get that signature non-conference win?
Well, I want to see a deliberate Butler defensively and offensively. I want to see them go into Oklahoma and set the tone on the road. Play their game and make Oklahoma play to their game and their tone. That is going to be big on the road.
Another timeout.
Is it that it was just everybody had extra timeouts and they just want to burn them right now?
Yes. And Butler still has one to burn, but that's the last for Saginaw Valley.
This is like when you leave. This is like you don't want to leave Chuck E. Cheese with tickets in your pocket. You want to figure out how to get a prize with the tickets you got. You just throw them all on the counter.
As I try to gather myself here, here's been one of the issues for Butler offensively is that 50% of their offense has been from distance. Now, they've shot it really well from downtown, Dickey, but that doesn't always work. As we saw in the Maui Invitational, the teams that beat them defended them really well on the perimeter.
Well, that's again, Rice Golden needs to get his touches in the paint. Thompson needs to get to the paint and put pressure on the defense. You saw Jaden Taylor have that ability. It's all about putting pressure on the defense, getting to the paint, whether it's a pass to the post or whether it's penetration by the guards. That is what opens up the three. And another thing that opens up your perimeter shooting where you don't have to rely on it is when we saw them get that play in transition, it was a paint touch to kick out to David for opening three.
And it was the defense that led to the transition.
Absolutely.
And defense has been Butler's calling card.
Absolutely.
This year, as it has seemingly always at Butler. They're ranked 31st in the country in scoring defense and first in the Big East. And Laval Jordan continues to preach that as this team figures out its identity offensively.
And they have a mixture of talent where they have length to help defensively. They have some young guys with a lot of energy to set the tone. They have guards who can rebound like Harris just did. So they have a variety, a combination of a lot of talent that can do a variety of things defensively. Hopefully Harris didn't hurt his wrist.
He's calling to the bench. He needs a substitution as he holds his left wrist tight to his body. And now Christian David will check in for Harris, who missed the last game due to inflammation in his foot. Questionable coming into the night. Did not start as they limited his minutes a little bit. We hope it's nothing too serious. He'll shake it off and be ready to go for Oklahoma on December the 7th.
James Tuohy for Saginaw just came onto that baseline out of bounds screen like he was Steph Curry. He just came off and caught that thing and let it go quick. Now that's quick release right there.
Well, they've certainly shot it better from three in the second half. Only made three triples in the first half, shot 30%. But they have gotten it up to 8 of 22 as Lukosius knocks it in, and Butler's back up by 10. It'll be really interesting to see what Butler is like, particularly offensively, when they get Bo Hodges back, Miles Tate, and of course Bryce Sinzi, who's arguably been their best player, certainly in the post, to start this season.
Coach Jordan will have a task of how to blend those guys back in to the chemistry that they have established with the young guys and with the guys that have been playing in their place. So that will be a task that he'll have to balance out.
Butler gets it done. It wasn't always pretty. Saginaw Valley State had it at three at the half, but Butler pulls away.